Hello everyone, thank you for coming. My name is Elazar Leibovich. I work at Next Silicon on different architecture for computation. And I want to speak today about undefined behavior. So I want to show you examples of real-world undefined behavior related bugs. I'll speak a little bit about less known undefined behaviors. And I'm going to survey mitigations, a way to cope with undefined behaviors. And I'm going to debate about whether or not the optimization based on undefined behavior carry their weight, are really cost efficient. So what is undefined behavior? The technical aspect of undefined behavior is a breach of contract. The standard maintains no requirement on a program with undefined behavior. One strike and you're out. Not only the function that contains the undefined behavior can do whatever it wishes, all your program, once undefined behavior reached, has no obligations. Scott Meirs popularized the allegory of nasal demons. Even demons can come out of your nose if undefined behavior happens. This picture, by the way, is the best I could convince Midjourney to draw nasal demons for me. And I tried really hard. But I think this is not the essence of undefined behavior. This is just a technical aspect. The essence of undefined behavior is the culture and the values about what happens when the compiler meets undefined behavior. Every language will have some undefined state, and the question is, what's our culture, how to manage it? The language will be designed to avoid error-prone features and to maximize automatic detection of programming error. This is on the first page of the C++ standard. No, not really. This is from the Ada programming language, and these are. It presents different values than what C++ has today. C++ puts a lot of weight on benchmarks and on performance, and less weight on debuggability and on programmer ergonomics. Why should we care? So a common rebuttal when I present the problems of undefined behavior is, why should we care about undefined behavior? If we have undefined behavior, we already broke the law, we're already in a bad shape, let's just not do that. Let's just not do that and we'll be fine. Why do we care what happened after undefined behavior is in vogue? And there's an amazing story in a book describing 20 years in the Soviet gulags, in the Soviet prisons, and the author of the book, he was tried, but the trial was not in the Soviet courts. It was a trial of his fellow criminal prisoners. And this man inadvertently insulted the Biatka, the king of the thieves there. And the thieves tried him according to the laws among the outlaws. And he was able to get away because he was fluent with the unwritten criminal law. He knew that one thing any thief must never do is squealing. And he remembered that this crime lord squealed to the NKVD, the former KGB, 20 years ago. That's how he was able to get away. And like in the Soviet Union back then, I think that in the C++ world, it's important to understand what can happen once you're breaking the law and once you're in the land of the outlaws. So let's go right ahead to the first real-world example. It's from the Linux kernel. It's a pretty simple code. We set a variable to one left-shifted by a certain value. Then we test for this value to make sure it's not zero, and then we divide by this value. This code looks pretty innocent. Can anyone spot the bug, spot the undefined behavior? Yes, please.
The shift could be wider than whatever groups perplexes.
The shift could be wider than 32 bits, which is one type, and this is undefined behavior, but one could reasonably think that whatever the result would be, it doesn't matter because we have a test for zero to the value, but this is not the case. What happens is that the compiler concludes that the group's perflex can never be zero because left shift more than 32 bits is undefined behavior and cannot happen. And therefore, it concludes the condition on the second line is redundant. And therefore, it just removes this condition. Removal of tests is a common theme among undefined behavior. This is another very famous project. And this is a quote from the bug tracker. It's some pretty old rickety code, but it has been working for years. This is a quote for the bug tracker when they were trying to hunt the bug that was caused by undefined behavior. And I think it's an important trait you can see with undefined behavior. A project has a very stable and well-tested code that worked for years over years. They do one thing, they upgrade the compiler. They upgrade the compiler. They don't even upgrade the standard version. They just upgrade the compiler and things start to crash. Again, a pretty innocent looking code. So we have here string copy, assignment, and nullability test. So you can probably guess that the nullability test is removed, but why that? So, the compiler can assume that the pointers given to strcpy are never null, even if the length is zero. And therefore, it assumes old is not null. And because we assigned the CP from, we assigned old to CP, we assume CP is not null, and we don't need this test. It's pretty subtle. It's not hard to, at least for me, it's not easy for me to follow this line of logic. Again, a real bug that real people have had to cope with and debug. This is from Ceph, a very famous distributed file system project. Again, from the bug tracker. I suspect that this is related to microcode updates. It appears to be an Intel TSX instruction that causes SIG illegal instruction. What happened is that Ceph received a bug report saying Ceph tried to run Intel instruction that is not supported on the CPU. And unfortunately, at the time, there was a CPU errata, there was a CPU hardware bug related to these instructions, so everyone was sure this is the root cause. You can probably guess that the root cause was undefined behavior, and the sin was, doesn't sound very severe to me, the sin was just unlocking a lock twice. They unlocked a lock twice and they got illegal x86 instruction ran. It's pretty surprising, and it's not easy to trace a root cause. And people were complaining, and they asked a better thing to happen, a more debuggable thing to happen when you unlock lock twice. And the essence of the answer for the request was, yes, don't do that. Don't do that, there's no problem. Just don't unlock a lock twice. And this goes back to what I said about the culture around undefined behavior. This is the world we live, and we need to be aware of it and to cope with it. The runtime won't always help you detect bad behavior. This is not from an open source project, but it's a blog post of a programmer describing a real bug in his proprietary program. I wasn't able to find anything which stated that a misaligned source leads to undefined behavior. I think that another claim that comes up in undefined behavior discussion is that user education is a problem. We didn't learn enough about the C standard. We should recite the C standard every day, and then we would write undefined behavior in our code again. And this is the case where the programmer was genuinely trying to avoid undefined behavior, but reading the standard, at least for me, is not an easy task. And understanding what exactly constitutes undefined behavior is not easy. And in fact, as far as I know, there's a working group that tried to enumerate all the undefined behaviors, but there's no real conclusive authoritative list of undefined behaviors. Again, this is a pretty naive looking code. You get a buffer of white characters and you copy it. What happened to the programmer is that he had this program working on Windows and he ported it to Linux, and then it didn't fail. He was very happy if it would fail. It usually worked, but sometimes it copied most of the buffer, but it missed just a few bytes. Can anyone think about what the problem in this code is? No, it's not about encoding. It's getting close. That's not exactly it, but it enables the bug. Can you come again? The buffer. So, by the way, about understanding the standard, I was looking for a very clear paragraph from the standard that explains the bug. This is the best I could come up with. Every object in C++ has alignment requirement, which, as far as I understand, are not our implementation specified. And the alignment requirement for white characters was different between Linux and Windows. The programmer made sure it's aligned and the requirement was 4. And again, we didn't get warning or error. We got, this is a pseudo function. I couldn't find a clear paragraph that's stating that copying white characters is illegal. This is a pseudo function that kind of says that. Another blog post describing real world bug. Somehow a Boolean variable simultaneously testing as both true and not true. Here the undefined behavior is not hard to find. B is uninitialized and you cannot use it. But you could still reasonably assume, and remember that the programmer did not have this simple 3 lines code, he had this embedded in a much larger code, that either B would be printed or not B would be printed. Right, that does make sense, whatever undefined behavior you invoked. But what actually happened here, that the first test was translated to non-zero test, and the second one just tested the first bit, probably because the compiler already had it in some registered, and therefore the conditions weren't really symmetrical and both happened. This is from the Java hotspot. No fsanitizer defined is fairly problematic with hotspot. So another claim I often hear is that tooling is our solution. Tooling makes undefined behavior not a problem because we have UbiSan undefined behavior sanitizer, and it can check undefined behavior for us. And as you can see here, this is not always relevant. You don't always have this tooling, and one of the good things about C++ is that it's portable to many, many architecture, but that makes tooling not always applicable. I think this is the shortest example I could find of surprising undefined behavior. This is just a constructor and initialization list. Let's expand the macro. Maybe the problem is in the macro. So the macro is just calling a member function to have its value returned and initialize the member in the initialization list. So can anyone spot the bug? Yes, that's the root cause. It's not about the question whether or not out is initialized, whether the member is initialized. It's the sheer fact of using the this pointer before the constructor begin. You cannot access any member, even if it was initialized in the initialization list. And this code again, it used to work, and it suddenly crashed after Hotspot upgraded the compiler. Yeah, go ahead.
Actually, the memory is allocated. So, trying to access member, it's only knows the memory is already allocated.
This is a good, I'll repeat the question. He's asking, how could that happen? I mean, the member is definitely allocated. I think it's a good question, and my understanding is that the compiler decided not to assign the register that is supposed to hold the this pointer before the constructor begins. And therefore, the register contained garbage, and he tried to access the offset of the member with a garbage pointer and got segfault. This is my understanding of the root cause of the bug and what the undefined behavior caused. Does that answer the question? No, init was not visual. I didn't analyze that. I read the postmortem in the bug report, but this was the paragraph they quoted from the standard to make sure it's not a compiler bug. And by the way, the common reaction of the programmer who runs into bug whose root cause is undefined behavior is, hey, this is probably a compiler bug. This is probably a library bug. This is very, very confusing. The cost is immense. This is the macro expansion, this is the code, and the macro is just calling a function that access a member. It might even have written to the member. I don't remember the actual code, but accessing a member in a function that is called in the initialization list. So let's go quickly over the last example. You can't speak about undefined behavior without mentioning strict aliasing, and here's the quote, it looks like a compiler bug to me. So I won't go into too much depth about strict aliasing, but the essence of strict aliasing is accessing an object with a pointer with different type. What I show you here is a common way to copy the first 16 byte of uint 64 in practice, just change the pointer and access the pointer, but this is strict aliasing violation and is technically undefined behavior. By the way, as far as I know, there's no big system project that has strict aliasing turned on. Linux turned it off. Microsoft compiler, Microsoft Visual Studio C compiler does not use optimization based off strict aliasing. But this is the essence of strict aliasing, and let's see another code from the Linux kernel. We have a very simple code. We set a member in a struct, and then we memcopy it to a stream of bytes. But the problem here is that the kernel could not use memcopy from the libc because the kernel does not have libc, and they couldn't use built-in memcopy because it was too slow. So they had to implement architecture-dependent memcopy, And the way they implemented it is roughly this. They casted the pointer because they wanted for the specific compiler, CPU to have 34 bits access, and they casted the, and they used different pointer to copy the actual bytes. So can anyone imagine what the compiler eventually did? So the compiler assumed that this wouldn't alias, that this, the pointer can never point to IWE, because IWE is a struct, and the memcopy uses a white pointer, which is not the struct, and therefore it just reordered. It decided to reorder the member assignment with the memcopy. And of course, and again, this is a very, very, very surprising and hard to detect bug, a real bug from the Linux kernel. And this is probably part of the reason they decided to turn off strict aliasing. Let's go over very quickly about less known undefined behavior. So everyone knows that invalid pointer cannot be dereferenced, but invalid pointer cannot be even compared. And there's a cute example someone came up with. I think it's John Rieger, a professor for C. And here we have a pointer that we allocated. We reallocate, and you should know that reallocating might free and thus invalidate P. And then we have this piece of code. If the pointers are equal, just print them. So again, UB or not, one could reasonably assume that either two identical values would be printed or nothing at all. You can probably get that in practice in some compiler, he got two different values to be printed because the compiler assumed P is, if P is invalid, it wouldn't be compared. This is a thing that people usually do. Accessing a union through a different member than the one you set it is technically undefined behavior. I think people do that all the time, and I'm not aware of a real world bug caused by it, but it's technically undefined behavior. And again, about pointers, just calculating the pointer past the end of the array, not using it, just the act of calculating it is undefined behavior. And likewise, subtracting two pointers, which is very common in system programming because you have certain assumptions on the pointers of your architecture, but just subtracting the pointers is undefined behavior. Mitigations. So we already mentioned UBSAN, which I think is an essential tool and every project have to use it. It doesn't catch all undefined behaviors. I recall a paper that said UBSAN undefined behavior sanitizer. We're running out of time, so let's speak after the presentation. TIS interpreter is less known. It's interpreter, it's more thorough, but it can't handle your entire project. It's good to keep in mind that these two exist. Compiler specific flags. There are compiler flags that you should be aware of that disable specific problematic optimization you might want to use. And bisecting, using different version is a major theme when undefined behavior were investigated. I already mentioned that user education, in my opinion, is not a valid solution. But is it worth it? Do we actually get a lot of performance because of these confusing undefined behaviors? Then, again, I think my answer is no. You can see that even compilers that are supposed to be very safe are not that much slower than modern compilers, even that they don't use almost any optimizations. We have an open question whether or not even 10% performance degradation in benchmark means that our real-world program would suffer from the same 10%. And sometimes, by the way, benchmarks were able to be fixed. The optimization was disabled, but the code was changed, and it was fast again. And again, this is a real paper, I think that no real world project never relied on undefined behavior. Real world projects don't really use the C++ standard per se. They always have extra assumptions because it's impossible to have a system project without it. I think the key takeaway is that undefined behavior is confusing, can cause bugs. You should be aware of that. And as I said, I don't think it carries its weight. I think that there are other languages like Ada without undefined behavior that don't have performance problems. And you should be aware of compiler flags and UBSAN undefined behavior sanitizer and TS interpreter in order to mitigate the risk of undefined behaviors, because you'll definitely have undefined behavior in your project. Thank you, everyone. Is it time for questions?